the penalty for that which we deserve. And friends, that is what is so wonderful about Christmas. I wanted to read to you the words of the hymn writer, you know, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. As I was looking at this morning, this is the meaning of Christmas. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail, incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus, our Emmanuel. That's what Jesus did. Jesus Christ did, when he came to earth, what no nativity set could ever convey. I love to look at the nativity sets of Christmas. We have several of them all over our house. But when Jesus Christ became man, he did what no nativity scene could ever picture. The God of the universe became a man. Doesn't that say something about us? Does that not say something about how bad off we are? We like to think that we're okay, that we don't need other people's help, that everything is going good. Just let me act like a good person and go on my way. As long as I follow the Ten Commandments, then I'm okay. The fact of the matter is, we are so bad off that God himself had to become flesh in order to save us from our sins. Every one of us. The fact is that he loved us enough to do it. And that's what Christmas is all about. But that brings me to the final thing that I want to point out about the reality of Christmas. Not only does the reality of it all deal with who he is and what he did, it also deals with his purpose of grace. The Bible says that when the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. But we know that Jesus Christ is the truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Jesus. He is the standard of truth. But there's something that the secular world may not understand about Jesus, is that not only is he full of truth, he is also full of grace. The very purpose for which Jesus came was a purpose of grace. What does 1 Timothy 1:15 say? It says that Christ Jesus came into the world. Why? To save sinners. The angel told Joseph, you will call his name Jesus. Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. The very reason that he came was a purpose of grace. He came to save a certain group of people, a specific group of people, and that group is called sinners. And guess what? Every one of us are part of that group. Now, if you're here this morning and you're not a sinner, then you can just disregard everything I have to say this morning. Because this would mean absolutely nothing. But Jesus Christ came with the purpose of grace. He came to save people like you and people like me. He came to save sinners. And the most beautiful part, from our perspective, of the coming of Jesus Christ is that it is an act of grace. If we were not so bad off, it wouldn't be such a big deal. If we didn't need him so bad, it wouldn't be such a big deal. If there was any way, anyhow, that we could earn our way into heaven by being good, then Jesus' birth would mean absolutely nothing. The most beautiful part of it from our perspective is that it was an act of grace. If you're not a sinner, then you don't need grace. If you're not a sinner, then grace means nothing to you. It's like standing before court and the judge saying, well, I know that you did it, but I'm going to be gracious and let you off. You wouldn't feel good about that if you were an innocent man. You would be enraged at the judge for actually believing that you were guilty. You don't need grace, you need justice. But the fact of the matter is, because we are all sinners, justice is what none of us want. What we need is grace. For Jesus Christ, the very Word that became flesh and dwelt among us, the very Word who, whenever he came into this world, has allowed us to behold the very glory of God, this is the one who is full of grace. And it's because he came, eternal life, that we can experience true joy and true happiness, the kind of peace that only comes through Jesus Christ. Because not only through Him can we behold the glory of the Father, but He is also full of grace and truth. During the Christmas season, we love to watch all these Christmas shows that come on. Our kids love to watch all these Christmas specials of Rudolph and Frosty and all these other things. You know, they watched some Elf movie the other day. And all of those movies is entertaining. They don't really even entertain me very much, but as entertaining as they might be for the children, they have all seemed to miss the point, haven't they? There is one children's special, however, that I think seemed to capture the reality of Christmas, and that's Charlie Brown. You do remember Charlie Brown, don't you? I just love that movie and the climax of the movie. Charlie Brown is distressed and throws his arms up in the air. He says, "I give up. What is the meaning of Christmas? Can somebody tell me?" Everybody just kind of sits there with a blank look on their face. When all of a sudden, Lionel steps forward, he steps forward with that old raggedy blanket of his. And the spotlight shines down on Lionel, and he looks forward and says, "I know Charlie Brown. I know what the meaning of Christmas is." At that point, everybody looks at Lionel. And Charlie Brown looks with a question on his face, and Lionel says, "Today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Christ the Lord." That's the meaning of Christmas. Welcome to the reality of Christmas. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we can come here into the house of God and celebrate the fact that God became man in order to save people from their sins. Lord, this time of year is so special, not just because we're able to spend time with our family, not just because we're able to open presents, not just because it is a festive time of year. This time of year is special because we are reminded that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Father, I know that everyone in this room is a sinner. Father, I thank you for the fact that you've revealed yourself through Jesus and you have allowed us to behold your glory through him. Father, I pray that today as we leave this church and we go out to spend time with our families and do whatever it is that people are going to do today, that we forget about the familiar of Christmas, and that we focus on the reality, who Christ is and what he did, and the very purpose of grace for which he came. Father, I pray that you will speak to the hearts of your people this morning, that if there is somebody in here today that has never experienced Christmas for what it truly is, that today might be the day that you open their heart, Lord, to receive you, to recognize your majesty, your beauty, and your worth, to recognize that you are the only one worth living for, and you are the only one who offers hope. Father, I pray that everyone here today might understand that Christmas message. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Christmas is not about pine needles and eggnog and chestnuts on an open fire. It's not about Santa Claus and reindeer and jingle bells. Christmas is all about Jesus. It's not about the familiar Jesus that all the world sees. It's about Jesus who is the Christ, the one who became man to save people from their sins. I pray this morning, if you have not ever recognized the truth of who Jesus is, what he did, if you've not experienced the grace that only he can offer, then make this Christmas a Christmas to remember. As I come down and use the place, I'm going to offer you the invitation to come down and let me pray with you. Come down this morning and say, "Pastor, I want to know this Jesus. Pastor, I want to celebrate Christmas for what it truly means. And I want to experience worry about what everybody else is thinking or what anybody else is saying. Come down this morning and say yes to the Jesus of